everyone, welcome to my channel. My name is Elle, and on this channel I talk about music and everything I learned in my life journey as a musician. Recipe for bibimbap, which is a very popular Korean dish usually served in a hot stone bowl at Korean restaurants, and a few things about Beethoven's 9th symphony. I paired these two in the same video because they both give us the message that even in the midst of this chaos and everything being thrown at us and the very difficult process and the journey, everything will come together beautifully and joyfully at the end. First, let's cook. These are our main ingredients, and in addition to this, we need minced garlic, spring onion, and protein of your choice. Here I'm cutting zucchini, cut it like this, and thinly cut the carrot and onion. And here I'm defrosting my spring onion and beef. And in the boiling water, we are gonna cook spinach and bean sprout. Try not to overcook because we still want to have the texture intact. And for both of them, it's the same thing. We add salt, sesame oil, garlic, and sesame seeds, and spring onion, and we mix them together and give it a little time for the infusion to happen. And here we are gonna cook all of the rest of the vegetable with just a little bit of oil, and try not to mix them because we are gonna put them around the bowl one by one. And this is the sauce. We need a Korean pepper paste, sesame oil, and just a little bit of sugar, and mix them well. And while you make the sauce, make a sunny side up. And here I laid out all of the ingredients, cooked ingredients, and put the sunny side up in the middle of the rice bowl. And now you can just put each of the ingredients one by one around the bowl. And I have minced beef, onion, carrot, zucchini, mushroom, this one's a shiitake mushroom, spinach, bean sprout, and last but definitely not least, the sauce. And top it off with the sesame seeds, and there we go! This is the recipe for authentic Korean bibimbap, and it's a lot of work, but it's definitely worth it. Now let's talk about music. This symphony is talked about a lot and is considered as one of the most important and meaningful musical work of all time in history. And a lot of people know of the piece, but this piece is not an easy piece to either perform or listen to. So my hope for this video is to pinpoint some interesting parts for each movement so that these can guide you through your listening experience with more connection and understanding. The opening of the first movement is often interpreted as Genesis, the creation of the world, because of its ambiguous yet grandeur characteristic. Especially in the first movement, the struggle between good and bad, or light and darkness, is a very big theme, which is expressed through the alternation between the major and minor keys. However, Beethoven drops us a little hint about our happy ending
even before the secondary theme appears in the exposition. So the contour of Ode to Joy theme, which happens in the fourth movement of the symphony, goes da 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 la. The movement ends with a new sense of determination and dignity. The second movement is a slow movement, and the third movement is a fast and often scherzo movement in the symphony form. However, in this symphony, Beethoven switches the order of these two. So we have this very energetic and lively second movement. The opening of the second movement is quite iconic. Actually, the openings of all four movements in the Ninth Symphony are iconic. But this movement inspired Dvorak's scherzo movement in his Ninth Symphony, which is also very fun and beautiful and meaningful work. So please check that out. And the third movement opens with one of Beethoven's signature harmonic vocabularies, which is a contrary motion between the soprano and bass line. And you can find this contour in many different spots in Beethoven's famous works. One example of it would be one of his famous piano work, the second movement of his Pathetic Sonata. For me personally, this movement was really challenging to listen through before I actually study the piece. There is a reason for that. First, it's really slow, so sometimes it's difficult to feel the pulse. And secondly, the phrasing is a little unique. There's a statement by the string section and the echo of just the tail end of the statement by the wind. So it's not always an even like four measures structure. Also, there are multiple switches between 4-4 and 3-4 and tempo changes within the movement. And the famous fourth movement starts with this overwhelming outburst of the winds and brass and percussion. Followed by a cello and bass recitative. Recitative is actually a singing style in the opera genre. It's like in between actual singing and speaking. The notes are assigned, but there's a great flexibility in rhythm. In actual opera production, the singers have so much control and freedom with the rhythm. They usually, the conductors follow the singer's rhythm. And the recitatives can't be really called as a melody. It doesn't have enough musical logic that can be identified as melody, and it's the difficult part of the opera listening experience. So for me, that was the spot that I stopped listening to this symphony because, well, first, after the quiet third movement, the outburst of the opening of the fourth movement was just too much, and the recitative just sounded really weird. But now after studying it, I can tell you that it's supposed to sound a little strange to our ears. So in the opera, only the leading characters get to sing the recitatives. At this moment is the first time ever in the history of music that a recitative passage is written for instruments. Properly, it's called instrumental recitatives, and the cello and bass section were the lucky guys who got to play this groundbreaking innovation in music history. It is said that when they were rehearsing this symphony for the premiere, they had so much trouble playing these recitatives because the instrumentalists never had to play this style of music. But nowadays, this is one of the most iconic and significant orchestra excerpt for cello and bass. And the function of recitative is a storytelling. So if you listen to the beginning part of the fourth movement, it feels as if an old man is telling us a story through the voice of bass and cello. And in the middle of his storytelling, the opening of first, second, and third movement appear.
Thank you.
until we finally arrive at the Eureka moment of finding the main theme for the fourth movement, which is commonly known as Ode to Joy. The lyrics of Ode to Joy is a poem by Friedrich Schiller, and it sings about how we can find joy in small little things in life, and how the universe has our back, and that we should live through our lives with a positive and grateful mindset. The lyrics is in German, so I'm going to put the translation of the lyrics in the description box below so that you can read it through. And once you read through the lyrics and know what they are singing about, then you're going to be able to connect with this piece on a different level. Also, in the middle of fourth movement, Beethoven writes Ode to Joy in a different style variation, which is a Turkish march. interesting in a few different ways. First, Turkish march was actually a very popular style of music even from Mozart's time. And it's because of the Ottoman Empire's siege of Vienna. And musically, it symbolizes exoticism and cultural diversity. Also, the Turkish marches were usually played as an outdoor music. So with a joyful, energetic, and positive context of Ode to Joy, having the Turkish march contributes to creating a festive mood of the music. And the Turkish march is actually a military march, and the lyrics that follows this section talks about how we should joyfully live our lives as if we are the heroes of victory. So putting the military march before singing about the heroes of victory was a very clever musical move by Beethoven. Also in this movement, there's another very interesting spot, which happens to be my favorite spot in the entire symphony. Here, Beethoven puts all of the voices and all of the instruments in the very high range of their capacities and in pianissimo in dynamics. Both for singers and instrumentalists, producing high sound in a quiet volume is really, really challenging. However, it creates this beautiful and mysterious aura of sound. And the context of the lyrics at this moment is how God is above all the stars of this universe. And if you keep this context in your mind when you listen to this spot, you can actually feel like you're zoomed out of the earth to the space without the gravity and without the air to feel the sound, and you're like muffled. And Beethoven actually writes all the instruments to tremolo, creates this musical illusion of stars twinkling all around you in the space. In my personal interpretation, this piece is a narration of four seasons of life. The first movement is about our childhood. So a spirit becomes alive and we search for our identity in this movement. The second movement is about our 20s, 30s, and 40s, where we drive forward in life with energy, optimism, fun, and courage and velocity. Third movement is about midlife crisis. So it's reflective, melancholy. There are a lot of questions and answers and inner conversations. And it's beautiful yet somewhat painful. And the fourth movement is when we finally reach the enlightened or wise state at the end of our lives. So it's open-minded, inclusive, generous, patient, and masterful. And the message we get at the end is to always look for joy in small things in life, to stay humble before God, always know that universe has your back, and the life is a blessing no matter what. Beethoven experienced very abusive childhood. His father was an alcoholic who abused him physically, emotionally, and mentally. The father pressured Beethoven from a very young age to become a prodigy superstar like Mozart because he wanted to make money off of his son's talent. And it didn't go well. That was out of Beethoven's control. And Beethoven had his hearing loss starting in his 20s that haunted him all through his life ever since it started. Also, he was never successful in his romantic love relationships. And he was a little socially awkward and misunderstood by many different peoples in his life. So I assume that he struggled a lot with loneliness, social anxiety, and self-esteem issues. Also, his time in history was quite turbulent. There was French Revolution, Napoleonic Wars, the First Industrial Revolution. And all these things caused so many social, political, economic changes in the society. Like 2020 that we are living through. Actually, Beethoven is considered as one of the first freelancing musician because the culture of court and European aristocrat, which traditionally supported musicians, disappeared during this time. So he knew quite well how painful and difficult life could get. And still at the end, his final message to humanity is seek God, the universe has your back, enjoy your journey, and life is a blessing no matter what. As I'm filming this video, I am leaving September 11, 2020, and today was very difficult for me emotionally. I mean, 2020 has been a difficult year for all of us, and September 11th is a quite traumatic day for our generation. I also had some personal things going on. However, I'm very thankful that I can share my knowledge and understanding of the Ninth Symphony and break it down a little simpler so that more people can connect to this masterpiece and be consoled by old Beethoven's genuine encouragement to humanity through his masterwork. I hope you enjoy your bibimbap and listening experience of the Ninth Symphony by Beethoven. Thank you for spending time with me, and I'll see you in the next video. Bye!